My name is Karat, and I've lived here in the US for most of my life. Well, I was actually born in Mumbai, India. When I was 3 years old, my parents made the huge decision to move to New York. Life in India at that time was really difficult, and they wanted to give their children the chance for a better future. So now I'm a US citizen, and I went to school here in the States my whole life. Let me first tell you a little bit about India. A lot of people live there. It has the second largest population in the world, 1.2 billion people. Today, India is becoming a global superpower. But the road to progress has not been easy. With such a huge population came struggles just as big. And even though millions of kids now live comfortable lives, there are millions more still living in extreme poverty. But technology is changing lives in ways we couldn't have imagined just a few years ago. The same GPS technology I might use on my cell phone while I drive to a friend's house is now completely transforming the lives of tribal communities in remote India. GPS, which stands for Global Positioning System, is a satellite-based navigation system consisting of 31 orbiting satellites in space. Each satellite sends out a high-frequency, low-powered radio signal. Your GPS unit receives signals from satellites to determine exactly where it is, using a process called trilateration. Trilateration determines locations by measuring distances and using the geometry of circles, spheres, or triangles. Your GPS unit measures its distance from each satellite by tracking the time it takes to give and receive the radio signal. GPS was originally created for the US military, but in the 1980s was made available to the general public. Today, GPS exists freely for use anywhere in the world, truly anywhere. Remote Indian villages that don't even have electricity or running water are using GPS technology to fight for their land ownership rights. This is a story about the tribal people of Sagai village, located in the national forests of Gujarat.
Tribals are not part of the mainstream society. They've been living in the hills, within the forests, for centuries.
For hundreds of years, Great Britain ruled all of India, and any forests were considered property of the government, regardless of whoever was living there. India gained independence from the British in 1947, but the forest lands were simply taken over by the new government.
Their situation was very bad because they didn't have any legal means of livelihood. Whatever they did to eke out their livelihood, it was considered as criminal. They were considered as thieves in their own land.
Local villagers, desperate to eke out a living, began to farm the land illegally, growing food for their families.
I mean, since they had no legal rights, Forest Department officials would try to evict them and sometimes use that as an extortion mechanism that, you know, unless you pay, we are going to send the bulldozer or send the tractor to uproot your crops.
Villagers were fearful to improve their land. It was too risky to dig wells or use a tractor. If a forest official was abusive or demanded a bribe, they had nowhere to turn.
By early 2000, the lives of the tribal population in most of India were similar to the poorest of the poor in India.
We came to a couple of villages and we saw their plight. Their situation was just like near starvation. They couldn't get 2 square meals a day. It was not a good situation.
In 1991, as economic reforms were erupting across the country, tribal communities and their advocates began to organize and speak out about property rights, laying claim to the lands on which they were living. In 2006, the national government passed the Forest Rights Act, creating a provision for tribal peoples to gain legal rights to their traditional lands. Rama Bhai and his family live in Sagai village in the national forests of Gujarat. Rama is a farmer and a tribal leader in his village.
Gradually, everyone heard the news of the new law which was introduced that land prior to 2005 may be allotted by law.
But there was a catch. In order to gain ownership of their land, villagers had to prove that they were farming a specific piece of land prior to December 31st, 2005.
In situations like these villages, there is no one who's recording who's farming when and how. How would you prove that?
Everyone made a map of their land. We used thread to mark boundaries and measure an area to make the maps.
But the hand-drawn maps weren't enough. The government insisted on an official paper trail with a history of government-issued documents proving ownership.
When I applied, our application was declined and we were not given the title to our land. Almost everyone was refused.
After a long review, the government only approved 10% of the applications. It looked like most villagers were back where they started. But then they came up with a new idea. What if they could use Google Earth satellite maps to prove that the villagers were farming specific plots of land prior to 2006?
So the satellite images on Google Earth was one instrument by which we thought it's possible. So what happened was that archival images became available. So in some places we have images from 2002 and 2004, which means that you get a picture of the history. So if in 2005 you see this forest, you know this was a forest. If it was an open field, you can see that on the image. So if you see that boundary, there is no way you can deny that this plot was being farmed. And there was no other way to show it in such a dramatic manner as the satellite images.
The next critical step was to create accurate boundary maps that could be superimposed on the satellite images. Small handheld GPS units made that possible.
You switch it on, get the satellite signal, walk around the perimeter of the field that you want to map. Transfer it to a computer. You'll be able to see the plot boundary on the image and you'll know where it has got.
And you see what was the condition of this particular piece of land in, say, if the image is of 2005, whether it was under forest or it was under cultivation. You can easily see.
So tribal villagers had really clear maps to hand in with their applications. Now, thanks to the GPS maps, nearly 90% of their applications were approved.
This technology has really been a boom. If the law was passed 10, 20 years ago, these technologies didn't exist. So people would have had to struggle to prove and help implement the law.
Now they are no longer encroachers. They are no longer criminals. These people are now very confident that now we own this land. And that has snowballed into so many other things.
This is now my land and I'm feeling very happy. I'll plow the land and cultivate it myself. I'll labor hard and never sell it. In the slope part, I plan to grow mango saplings and other forest trees.
Forests that were entirely cut down under the forest department are now being replanted thanks to the tribal villagers.
Before, the forest department wouldn't allow us to dig a well because we didn't have a title for the land. Now we own it. I started by digging a small well, but now 8 or 9 families are making this well together. We are now digging a bigger well to get more water.
After 10 years, the situation has dramatically changed. Most of the parents now seek to send their children to good schools. So that is the dramatic change. They are spending lots of rupees on the education of girls also.
So now they can even plan for improving it further, make long-term investments and all those things. But the greatest thing which they feel is that now we can live with dignity. We are getting respect. Because now we are no longer encroachers or we are no longer illegal lawbreakers. So when we are cultivating this land, we can cultivate this land keeping our heads high.
So the first time they feel as they are true citizens in a democratic country, that they are respected when they go to a government office. You know, they are still poor. Things have not changed here dramatically. You don't see industries or big capital investment. But the sense of pride and dignity is going to last them a lifetime.
We may think of Google Maps or a GPS unit as a simple thing that comes in most cars today. But for the people of Sagai Village in India, GPS technology transformed their lives. People who have been landless and powerless for generations can now shape their own future. The key is ownership. The land is now theirs, the well they've dug is theirs, and their ownership is protected by the law. This is the power of property rights. If you own it, you will take care of it. So the next time you use your cell phone to get directions somewhere, think about how this same technology helped tribal people of India gain ownership of their traditional lands. Think about how those lands are being managed more carefully and more environmentally friendly than before. The land is benefiting from that, and so are the people of India.